Hi, and welcome to the third annual STMS History Expo. This year, the theme is Taking a Stand in History. We have students who've done posters, which our entire gym is pretty much filled with. We have a skit this year. We have websites. We have a documentary. And all the 6th, 7th, and 8th graders have been involved. This year, we got prizes from Sweet Frogs on Kent Island. We got prizes from Chick-fil-A on Kent Island, and some Google Play gift cards that students will be getting for exemplary projects that the teachers have decided upon. We also will be having the Geography Bee event tonight as well at 7 p.m., where we have 9 individuals from the school who got perfect scores on the Geography Bee taking part in the final round event, where we will end up with a final winner for the school. So hopefully, as you go through and see all the activities and such here, you enjoy it, see some really neat things, and each year the projects get better.
This all ends up in History Day, correct?
Correct. The students will be chosen to move on to the County History Day, which will be at Queen Anne's County High School this year on February 11th. We have, so far, students from Southersville, Mattapique. We'll have students from Centerville and here at Stevensville. We also have some high school students from Queen Anne's County High School and hope to get some from Kent Island as well. The winners at the County History Day will move on to the state. Those are first and second place winners. Those winners can go for specialty awards for ranging from scholarships. They range from prizes from local agencies such as the Naval Academy. They also have agencies for the state of Maryland. If they win at the state, they can move on to the national level where they get full ride scholarships to colleges, and they also get to meet different actors, actresses, and governmental individuals in June at the University of Maryland College Park.
Nice how everything's kind of local.
Yes, everything for us is local. This usually everything for History Day is. State History Day is usually at UMBC, and I believe this year it will be in May.
All right, so what do you think of this year's props and projects?
Projects we have so far this year are very good. Our 6th and 7th grade projects this year are exemplary. 8th grade has some very good websites and documentaries this year, so we can really see the technology use getting bigger and better every year.
Technology is a huge part of that.
Yes, with the students having the one-to-one initiative with the Chromebooks, we have a lot of kids taking advantage of these types of opportunities, and we also see a lot more students getting much more comfortable with this type of medium, where they are able to move forward and be successful.
When do these projects start?
Varies. Usually this year, we all began around the middle to end of October. Students then start working on gathering research, where they will then gather and show that to their teachers. They then work on getting the annotated bibliographies, and then they work on the visuals. So this is a multi-month process where students have some time in school and sometimes out of school that they have to work on these projects.
So would you say, without bias, that Stevensville Middle School has the best projects?
Well, I would say, based upon what we've seen so far, having not seen Centerville, Southersville, or Mattapique, we have some very good projects. Now, having worked at County History Day for as many years as I have, we definitely are seeing some amazing projects over the years. We've been doing County History Day now going on 8 years, and it's really, really ramping up to be very good. And every year the projects get better. We have some awesome judges coming in this year for County History Day. We've got judges coming from Washington College. We've got judges coming from Chesapeake College, from the United States Naval Academy, the Maritime Museum. We have some really big people coming in for us this year. And we have the Maryland Humanities Council coming in, and they are actually going to be taking part as well in looking over our project. So we've got a big state representative coming in to see us this year at our county competition. I think we have a very good shot this year. We always traditionally do some very good things, and I think we'll definitely have some good representation up at the state level.
I'm Allie Green, and I'm in 6th grade.
What are you going to show us?
I'm going to show you my website that I did on the Greek. There's a Greek poet named Homer. There's not much information known about Homer because some people don't even think he existed. There's very little known about him. He was believed to be born between the 850 BC and he died in 800 BC. He's also believed that he lived before a chronological dating system. He was born in Asia Minor. As far as we know, Homer composed very long, complex poems such as the Iliad and the Odyssey. They were very long and many pages long. He composed in the style of minstrel or balladeer. Homer was the first to compose the epics. Homer sang the Iliad and the Odyssey as well as writing them. He changed the way classical literature was wrote, and he didn't really like the way it was written, so he decided, I'm going to change it. And that's pretty much what his stand was.
Well, let me ask you some questions. One, why did you pick Homer?
I picked him, one, because my dad's name is Homer, and I just thought that was kind of cool.
Very cool.
And two, I like poets, and I thought it'd just be cool to learn some more about different poets and different poetry styles.
What surprised you? What surprised you that you learned?
It surprised me that not many people know about him, and like that there's not many like facts about him, because like they say there's like not much known.
Or name that we know, we don't know much about.
Yeah. So it's kind of hard to do the project.
Well, yeah.
I did it.
Do you like the poetry?
Yeah, I do.
You'd recommend it?
Mm-hmm.
Do you like the big adventures, like the Iliad and whatever?
Mm-hmm. I read them in I read them in fourth grade.
Okay.
I like the Iliad just because it's like more adventurous in it, because I like adventures, so.
There you go. What did you do? So it looks very good. Is it a website or a project?
It's a website.
So you, what did you use to do that?
I used Weebly.com.
I need to have this one, and I'm doing my expo on George Washington, and I wanted to learn more about his battles, so I thought that George Washington and reading his books would do a lot for me. So in here it basically says that when he led his army, he had people go and see what the other, if he has an army, he's going to see what the other army is doing. So that's
research.
Research. So basically it's telling what his battles were about, why he became president, and yeah.
Where everybody thinks they know all about George Washington, what did you find out that surprised you?
I found out that he sent people as like undercover to other armies. I found out that.
Right. Research, more research. Are you impressed with him now as you were before? Or you just know more now?
I know him more now.
Would you recommend reading about Washington?
Yes.
Would you recommend doing a project about Washington?
Yes.
Would you recommend using the software you did to create it? What did you use?
I used Google Slides.
Pretty hard? Hard to do?
Yes, it is. Because you have to find certain research about it. And
so you're looking for data and pictures all at once, right?
Yes.
How long did it take to do?
It took me since the beginning of, I think, December or November. It was one of the two.
Very good. Thank you.
Skit.
What is your
okay. I will turn the floor over to Mr. Mason Green.
All right, I'm just gonna let you guys know right now I'm a little bit scared. So, all right, does that work? That works. Great. Mr. Thomas Alva Edison was born to the family of Samuel Edison and Nancy Elliott on February 11, 1847. In Milan, Ohio. He started school at the age of 6, but then later left in 1859 to begin working on a railroad. He had very little education. He was taught reading and writing by his mother. In 1954, Thomas and his family moved to Port Huron in Michigan. But by 12, he had lost almost all of his hearing by a fire on a train exploding. Later, when his first wife died, he remarried 20-year-old Mary Stillwell. He was 24 years old. Then later, he had 3 children, which I like to call monkeys. By 1872, his first invention of the electric light bulb came to be. It was said that it was what Mr. Edison was most famous for. With other inventors, he tested 3,000 light bulbs between the years 1878 and 1880. 5 years later, his next invention was the phonograph. that was made in 1877. Many people said that the phonograph was the first ever to be able to produce any recorded sound. After all of his famous, now we have a quick video that I forgot. Okay, skip that video. After all of his famous and hard work, he'd often vacation with inventor Henry Ford in winter homes. Then he moved. Then he moved to West Orange, where he later died at age 84 on October 18, 1930. He died from complications of his diabetes. And these are other pictures of his light bulbs, of this photograph, and Thomas Edison himself. And these are the places where I found my answers. I'm Mason Green.
What did we see?
A presentation of Thomas Edison.
Why did you pick Edison?
Because without him, we wouldn't have the lights that we have in classrooms and everywhere.
I'm going to assume you knew something about him. What surprised you the most?
That I've always noticed that he only made the light bulb until I did this project, and he also made the phonograph, which was really cool.
And a huge range of other projects, right?
Yes.
What did you use to make your PowerPoint, or the project, I'm sorry?
I used Google Slides and multiple other websites.
And you had a video. What was on the video?
The video was basically a summary of what was going on in my project.
Why did you choose to go live instead of other ways?
I love presentations. I love presenting in front of people, even though like sometimes I get really scared and embarrassed.
Good job. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Go. Who are you, please?
My name is Chase Karam.
What are we looking at here, Chase?
We made a website of Paul Revere, and then we made a PowerPoint of Paul Revere.
Why'd you pick Paul Revere?
We think like he stood up for the Tea Act and the Boston Party, and he was part of it by throwing all the tea overboard. And also, he did "The British Are Coming." The British Are Coming.
Is that true? Is that like a? It is true.
Yes.
Two up by C.
Yeah.
Two up by land.
Yeah, that's.
All right. Why did you pick him?
Because we thought like he standed up for something.
What surprised you about him? You probably knew something about him, right? Sure.
Yeah.
But what surprised you?
Surprised
you. What knocked you over?
I don't know.
All right. That's an unfair question. How did you create this website?
We went on this website called Weebly.com, and you just have to make an account, and then you make a website.
Pretty easy when you get started?
You just have to publish it. It takes a couple of hours. Or it depends on the internet. So
you like the project overall?
Uh-huh.
Good job.
My name is Danny Wilson.
And you also worked on the Paul Revere project, right?
Yes.
So what surprised you?
What surprised me is that he had 14 children.
Get out!
Yeah, and he had two wives, though.
At the same time?
No. At different times.
Wow. Was that normal back then?
Yes. I'm not sure.
Very cool. So you guys found a lot of cool stuff. Anything more to say?
Nope.
Good job, Danny.
Yeah, nice job, Danny.
Good job. All right, who are you, please?
My name is Christopher Penley, and this project is about King Xerxes. King Xerxes was born in 519 BC, and he had died in 465 BC. He had lived in Persia. And King Xerxes was in the Persian Empire and invaded Greece, which were some of the most important battles in ancient time.
Right, hold on 1 second. Let me ask you some questions, okay?
All right.
We can get back to it. Why'd you pick, is Xerxes, is that how you say it?
Yeah, King Xerxes.
Why did you pick him?
Because he's like a king, and he was like from history and all.
Do you stand?
and he stand for up against the Greeks and prove that he could beat the Greeks.
Did you know anything about this dude until you read it in a book somewhere?
Until I read it into a book.
And why'd you pick him? Because he's a neat guy. What surprised you about him?
That he was in a Persian war that's in like ancient history. And I wanted to learn more about ancient history.
Would this guy be a good movie?
Yes, there's a movie with him in it, the 300.
Oh, okay, very good. What did you use to make your project?
I used a website that had like a homepage that's about him and then like where he lived and when he fought against the Greeks and his oldest son and him had died and his other son had been king. Then my citations where I got my information.
Very good. A lot of research, a lot of time to do it.
Yeah.
Very good. Good job, man. You guys go. Who's Thank who? You.
I'm Dylan McKelvey.
And I'm Tyler Russell.
What is your project?
We did the 1966 NCAA basketball championship where Texas Western beat Kentucky.
Why did you pick that?
We picked it because we thought it would be a good topic and like everyone likes sports.
There you go. What surprised? I mean, I see you guys know your sports. What surprised you about this?
Well, Texas Western was the first team with all black starters to win an NCAA basketball championship, and still to this day are the only team from Texas to win.
And one thing that surprised me is that they played at Coldfield, Maryland.
Is it really? Very cool. Why? Because they end up playing Maryland here?
Yes.
Wow. What did you use to make your project?
We used Weebly for education.
Very good. Was it fun to do?
Definitely.
Good job. All right, go. Good job. Who are you guys?
My name is Devin Anderson, and this is Joshua Blair. We were creating this project for Muhammad Ali. Reason me and Josh did this project was our inspiration about Muhammad Ali. I was the one who liked him most, though. Josh liked him too. But me and my dad were watching a lot of boxing shows about him. Even so, I became so inspired about Muhammad Ali. So I decided to create this project for Muhammad Ali. Even though he's the world's greatest boxer, he's still an intelligent man.
And ended up being very important for a lot of ways, right? All right, what surprised you the most about Muhammad Ali?
Everything. The most thing that surprises me is his knockouts and his world championships and pretty much that.
He also had a ton of wins. He had like a lot of knockouts. Well, a little bit of losses, so he still got the hang of it, though.
Could you say that he was more important in later years?
Yeah.
And why?
Well, mostly he would like
He was our boxer.
He was our like favorite boxer and all. Even though he was still a favorite boxer, we still chose his project.
He was our American boxer.
Okay, very good. What did you use to make the project?
We used a documentary for our project. We used a couple pictures for our document, and we put up a couple websites for the project also.
You put up two websites? More than one?
Four, actually.
Okay.
And then after that, me and Josh did some of the work. And then after that, we did the pictures. And then we decided to do the bibliography. We decided to edit all that. What sites were which. All that stuff.
It must have been a ton. Here's a case where you had a ton of information and pictures and articles or whatever, video, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you had to choose carefully.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you very much. Good job.
I think taking a stand for freedom, and I chose this because I like Ireland, and Ireland's one of my favorite states, and a lot of things happen in the Easter uprising, like, and this one, it's, what, like, here is the civilians that are suspects, and these are the 10 men are in jail. And then, and this one is the 15 men that were identified as leaders that got executed in a jail. And then this flag is the Irish flag they used in the fight. And it represents the rebellion.
Now, what surprised you the most?
What surprised me the most was why they started it, because they wanted to be free from British rules.
And still do, to some degree, right?
But then they lost the war, but when in 1921, they actually gained their freedom and independence. So this one, they declared that Ireland was a free state. And that's what happened in the Easter Uprising.
Okay, who are you?
I'm Aaron Bowen.
Yep.
I did this about Nelson Mandela. He did an act to stand for all color equality. What really surprised me when I was learning about this was he went to jail for 18 out of 27 years. And then after that, he became the first African-American president of South Africa.
Wow. Was it hard to do? Put it together? A lot of research, right?
Yeah. It was hard to put together because I thought that I had to do all these different things about it, but I realized that it was really easier than I thought it would be.
Good job. Excellent.
My name is Luke Oliver, and I chose the medal from Mumbly. The reason why I chose this, well, my teacher chose it for me. She chose it for me.
And,
this is the battle between the Spartans and the Persians. And what they did, they took a stand for their kingdom, because if they didn't, then their wives and their kids would be slaves. And some people would be killed. So this would be represented as 300 Spartans, and this would be represented as 200,000 Persians. And they killed 100,000 Spartans.
Yeah.
And
half that huge army they killed.
I mean Persians.
Right.
They killed 100,000 Persians. And left behind 100,000 Persians who were left behind.
And
how did they do that? Just fighting abilities or strategy or what?
They strategy. Right here. Well, they made a little wall.
Yep.
And they had protectors here. This is Leonidas.
Okay.
And this is what they did. They had people coming through the wall, and they, since they chose this, so then very few little people can be attacked. Very little people can fight over here.
Mm-hmm.
So they would close in, and they would push their shields and then stab. And, yeah.
How long does battle take?
About... 3 hours.
100,000?
Yeah, it was really short for it would take about a day.
Okay.
Because the long walk here.
Yeah, okay.
They went across the whole state.
Gotcha. So. What was the hardest part of making this project?
I think probably setting up the people and the spray paint.
Yeah.
And hot gluing it all.
I bet you were going to like history the rest of your life.
Huh?
I bet you were going to like history the rest of your life. You like this so much.
Yeah, I like this.
My name is Addie Churches, and my partner couldn't make it. Her name was China Chester, and we did the Boston Tea Party. The ship is the Eleanor, which is the ship that had all of the tea crates on it. And I...
Paging Mr. Apple.
Paging
Mr. Apple. Please come to the stage.
So we kind of did it half and half. And there's some tea crates in the water. And there's a tea crate coming.
Now, we've heard about this event forever. What surprised you about it?
What surprised me is how many of the founding fathers were in it. Like, I believe George Washington was part of it, and a bunch of other of the founding fathers.
Is that a... So you had to model the ship. How big was the ship? But it had a lot of tea. One ship, yeah. Right?
Yeah, it had, I think, over 1,000 crates of tea.
Very good. My last question. Do you like tea?
Yes.
So.
Teachers in their classes will be handing out the Sweet Frog gift cards from Kent Island. So some teachers have given those out already. Others will be giving those out tomorrow in class. Right now, we are going to have the awards given out from Chick-fil-A from Kent Island. And there are 5 awards going to be given out by a special guest.
Look out!
Thank Chick-fil-A for coming out tonight and supporting Stevensville Middle School History Expo 2016. They've been kind enough to provide us with some awards to give to a few of our students. Each teacher, history teacher, selected one student from their class as producing not only a remarkable exhibit, whether a website or a visual or documentary, but also their ability to present that information and demonstrate their knowledge. This is more than a science fair where they just created something. They really had to know what they were doing and be able to explain it. So, for my class, sixth grade, Mr. Barnum's history class, the best product I was able to, it was hard, nearly impossible to decide which is the best, but one student stood out, and her name is Grace Evans. She's not here today. She did a website that was absolutely amazing. For my partner in crime, Mrs. Zimmerman, she also did really well. She selected Chloe Stevens. Steve. There she is. Chloe produced a visual of Galileo right over here. It's got the nice it's got the planets. Heliocentric universe.
All right, for seventh grade, for my class, this student actually created an exemplary website. I've done this many years, and this is probably one of the best websites I've seen in a long time. Zoe Katz. Alright, for Mr. Sitar's class, we have Ryan Swider. And for Mr. Apple's class, the winner is Amara Crow. I don't know if Amara is here. Okay, Amara is not here. So, if you could give a round of applause to those five students. You can have a round of applause for Chick-fil-A and Cowboys.
We've come up with two students' overall websites, documentaries, visual products that just stood out amongst the rest, just in the quality and the time and just the complexity of what they decided to do. And they are going to be awarded a $10 Google Play. Thanks for the Historical Society. They provided us with these two gift cards for the sixth grade. A student obviously spent a lot of time and effort creating their product. It's Daniel Fish. He created a documentary that was absolutely incredible. He was going to basketball practice, and now he's got a $10 Google Play card. He did his documentary on the South African Union Act. He literally wrote, produced, and created a 10-minute long documentary with a little assistance from my mom, of course, but it's fantastic. It really showed what he was. Few Miss Chris.
The other Google Play gift card. This is by far probably one of the most interesting projects I've seen as well in a long time. When this one was brought in, it kind of blew me away. Freaked out my students. Freaked out fellow staff members. It was pretty good. It was pretty good. I don't know if any of you got a chance to see it. It's in the back corner over there. Life size. So the project on Jesse Owens and Matt is Will Ransom. So our next step is going to be now the geography game. Mr. Barton, I'll turn it over to you, sir.
Experts up here, Matthew Barabini, Maddie Peters, Anton Ross, Abby Pierce, Zoe Katz, JT Rubel, and Joseph Rondo. Last call for a few people that are missing here. We're missing Matthew Garavini and Manny Peters. Let's go ahead and get started. All right, first and foremost, I'd like to welcome you all to the Stevensville Middle School National Geography Bee Final. This is our final competition. Let's have a huge round of applause for our final contestants here. They look all very excited. Each year, the National Geo Bee empowers 4 million students to be informed, curious, and knowledgeable global citizens. Today, we'll determine our school champion, and that student will have the opportunity to advance to the next level of the competition. The national champion that takes place in Washington, D.C. has a possibility of a $50,000 scholarship from National Geographic and a prize trip. Now, unfortunately, because this event takes place at different times in different schools with the same grouping of questions, we cannot have live video recording of the question portion being asked. When we're asking questions, we can't record that just in case there's another school that hasn't done this part of their competition. And any activity that could be distracting to the contestants, I don't know who would do any of that. Just please let's support our contestants the best that we can. Today's competition will consist of a final round and a championship round. The final round questions will reduce the number of contestants to two. These two finalists will then compete in the championship round. In the final round, the contestant is eliminated after answering two questions incorrectly. I will begin each series of questions with the same student. If this student has been eliminated, questioning will begin with the next available student. Each student on stage has responded to a question in the series. Those who gave their second incorrect answer will be excused from the stage unless all are eliminated. If this happens, those students who gave their second incorrect answer during that series will continue to receive final round questions until two finalists and a third place winner are determined. If only one student remains after a series of questions, that student automatically becomes one of the finalists and will be asked no more questions. Those students who gave their second incorrect answers during the series will continue to receive questions until second finalists and third place winners are determined. The procedures will change for the championship round. I will announce those procedures at that time. Other rules remain the same as those that were filed in the preliminary competition. As a reminder, you will have 15 seconds to answer. And you must start to give your answer before the time limit is up. You may interrupt the final competition only twice to have either a question repeated or a word spelled. Also, remember to listen carefully to each question and use correct geographic terminology in your answer. For example, do not use Holland as a synonym for the country Netherlands. And do not use England for the country United Kingdom, Great Britain, and Northern Ireland. As England is a political division. There's a lot of expressions here. I apologize. Run out of breath. Your present day names, unless the questions involve history, and other names would be correct in the context of the question. As the Bee is conducted in English, wherever possible, conventional English place names are used. Short forms of country names are acceptable, such as United Kingdom, Great Britain, or Britain for United Kingdom, Great Britain, and Northern Ireland. You will not be penalized for inaccurate pronunciations or spellings, so long as it can be determined that you know the correct answer. Bee questions follow the National Geographic Society's policy of recognizing Europe and Asia as two continents. Oceania is considered a region rather than a continent and will not be accepted as the correct answer for the continent of Australia. In addition, the National Geographic Society recognizes four oceans: Atlantic, Arctic, Indian, and Pacific. All information is current at the time the Bee questions were finalized in September of 2016. And the rulings of the judge are final. And our judge, Mr. Christ. We thankfully have Mr. Kintop is going to be our scorekeeper. Mrs. Reddy is going to be our scorekeeper. You guys ready? You're not ready? Alright, I'm going to start with Kelsey. Remember, you have 15 seconds. The first set of questions is about the United States and will require oral answers. Each of you will answer a different question and you will have 15 seconds to give me your answer. Kelsey. Name? Excellent job. Kelsey, thank you. JT, thank you very much. JT, you're awesome. Thank you for just being back. And Joseph. So we are down to our final three contestants. The next set of final round questions involves a map that shows physical features of the United States. Each of you, in turn, will use the information on the map to answer your question. I will give you all a moment now to look at your maps. You'll be able to keep that map in front of you while asking questions. All right, here we go. When it is your turn, please look at your map while you read your question. Great job, Zoe. All right, now we're going to the finals. Congratulations to our two finalists, who will now compete in the championship round. The winner will be the champion of the Stevensville Middle School Geography Bee 2017. You will be competing with a clean slate. The championship round consists of three questions. I will ask both of you the same question at the same time, and you'll have 15 seconds to write your answers. When I call time, you'll put down your markers and hold up your answers. Then I'll ask each of you in turn to read your answers out loud. I will wait to give the correct answer until both answers have been read. Whoever correctly answers the most questions in the set of three will be the school champion. As before, you will not be penalized for inaccurate pronunciations or spelling, as long as it can be determined that you know the correct answer. If there is a tie after the set of three questions, I will explain the tiebreaker procedure. I will read each question twice, so you may not ask for another repeat or spelling. Listen carefully before writing your answers. Question number one. Now, we will have a tiebreaker round using a single elimination procedure. You will continue to write an answer for each question asked. The first contestant who correctly answers a question that the other one misses will be the school champion. As before, I will read each question twice. Are you guys ready? Patrick? Abby? You are ready now. Question number one. And our new champion with the correct answer is Abby Pierce. The irony is her brother won the same contest last year and the year before. Must be a family thing. What do you guys do at dinner time? Awesome guys. Again, thank you all for coming.
Thank you for coming. And we hope to see you again next year. Have a good evening, drive up safe.